welcome also to our visiting students. Hopefully this was useful for you to get to know more about our department as well. Okay. So in this second part, we will have four presentations, oral presentations by four of our PhD students in four different areas. And first one is on materials by Cody Dennett. And you can see the title on ions and lasers for new diagnostics in nuclear materials. Thank you, Cody.
Great, thanks, Boga. So welcome everybody again to the 2017 NSE Graduate Research Expo. My name's Cody, as she said. I'm a third year PhD student in the department, and I'm here today to talk to you about ions and lasers, and more specifically, how here at MIT we're using ions and lasers to develop new diagnostics for nuclear material science. Now, as many of you are here today as visiting students for the Department of Nuclear Science and Engineering, presumably you're interested in a nuclear system of some kind or another. You could be interested in fission systems or fusion systems. You may be even interested in nuclear security, disarmament, or stockpiled stewardship. Now, here at MIT, we're not only interested in how these systems as they exist now, but also what the future of these systems may look like. Oh good, Dennis isn't here, because what I meant to say is here at MIT, we're interested in what the future of these systems might look like. Now, these things all have many components in common, and the most interesting one to me is how these systems fail. They combine some of the most extreme environments that man has ever created. High temperatures, high pressures, corrosive fluids, extreme heat fluxes, and importantly to us, neutrons. The presence of radiation exposure causes the materials out of which these systems are made to fail in interesting and very unique ways. Now I'm going to talk today about radiation damage. So to do that, I'm going to take a step back and make sure we share a little bit of language to talk about that process together. Imagine you have a pure crystalline material with some neutron that's being exposed onto it. That neutron will hit an atom in the lattice and displace it from its equilibrium site. We call it the primary knock-on atom. The knock-on atom and the recoiling neutron will bounce around and continue to displace atoms from their equilibrium sites, creating what are called vacancies and interstitials. A vacancy is where an atom should be in an equilibrium lattice position. An interstitial where an atom has been forced between an equilibrium lattice position. Now, the way that we quantify the amount of damage that's been introduced into the material is by this unit called the dpa, or displacements per atom. Now, this dpa is an exposure parameter. So it tells you for every one dpa a material has seen, every atom in its crystalline lattice has been displaced from its equilibrium site one time. Now, for advanced nuclear concepts, some core structural materials will see up to 400 dpa by the end of lifetime. So a reasonable question to ask yourself is, what does that even mean? If you have more than even one dpa in a material, how do you still have a material left? Now, this dpa is at its heart an exposure parameter, not an accumulated damage parameter. So most of the atoms that get displaced from their lattice sites will immediately recombine to their equilibrium position, and it is only the very small fraction of atoms that do not, that are retained, that can move around, evolve, and agglomerate into the kinds of radiation damage that we're concerned with in nuclear systems. Now, this radiation damage can take many different and interesting forms, but one I'm going to focus on today is volumetric void swelling. Now, at a microstructural level, it can look like this. So this is a TEM image of a sample that has undergone an extreme amount of void swelling. So the matrix, the crystalline matrix here is white, and the voids are dark. Now, it's easy to see as you pump a material full of porosity like this, how you might change things like the thermal and mechanical transport properties, the neutronic transport properties. But even worse than that, for extreme amounts of damage, you can macroscopically change the size of engineering components in nuclear systems. And it's easy to imagine how systems may fail when their components get swollen out of spec like this. Now, since we know these types of procedures are going to happen with materials under irradiation, we need to test them and validate them in some sense before we can apply them into a nuclear system. And the most obvious way to do that would be direct neutron exposures in something like a test reactor. So at the MIT test reactor, we can get a total exposure of about 1 dpa per year for an in-core experiment. The highest you can get anywhere in the world is 25 dpa per year at the Bohr 60 reactor in Russia. Now, you immediately notice the problem of timescales here. If we have an advanced nuclear concept that needs to have 400 dpa for an in-core component by end of life, there's no way that we can test it in a situation like this. We can't get the exposures in a reasonable amount of time. Other problems include the fact that these reactors are sparse. They're hard to find. They're expensive. And even after you've been exposed to the material, you need to let it cool down because it will become activated during that process before you can test it. And the ways in which you can test these materials once irradiations are complete are destructive mechanical testing, by and large. So you expose a material, and then you break it and see how it fails. Or you do electron microscopy to see what the microstructure looks like. This is a framework that's generally what we call cook and look. You expose something and see what it looks like. Now, we can do a little better in terms of the dose rate problem if we move to ion beam exposures. So of the four ion beams on the screen, three of them are operated here at MIT by C-STAR. And the other one is operated at the Sandia ion beam lab that I've used in the past. And compared to 1 dPa per year, you can get up to 5 dPa at peak per hour in an ion beam irradiation, which solves a little bit our problem of timescales. Ion beams are also a lot easier to find, as evidenced by the ones that are here. And they don't activate materials, by and large, comparative to neutron irradiations. But there's still this problem in that we're using the same cook and look framework to test materials once they've been irradiated. So what this means is that even for ion beam exposures, we still have data that comes out looking something like this. This is a recent paper out of the University of Michigan from last year from Gary Wass's group, showing the high-dose void swelling behavior of several radiation-tolerant steels exposed under ion beam irradiation. Now, the details here aren't super important. What I'd like to draw your attention to is the distance between on the dose axis between data points here. Now, for these high exposure regions, there's 100 dPa between these last data points. In 100 dPa, an amazing amount of material evolution and radiation damage is occurring. And there may be very interesting components of material kinetics that we're washing over by taking data at such coarse resolution over such long timescales. So what we ideally like to be able to do is to use the flexibility of ion beam testing to reduce this dose resolution. And we think we can do that because ion beams, one, have multiple beam lines that you can attach many experiments to, and two, are generally very flexible. Here at MIT, they have an experiment where you do a plasma material interaction study as during ion beam bombardment. So we think we can develop a diagnostic to be able to look at the mechanical and thermal performance of materials under irradiation in near real time, given the flexibility of ion beam irradiation systems. Now, the technique we're proposing to use to do that is what's called transient grating spectroscopy. That's the picture I showed at the beginning. And at its heart, this method is a type of pump probe spectroscopy. So what we do is we have this general schematic. It's an all optical technique. It's non-contact, it's non-destructive. We force a material with some pumping laser source, and we monitor the response that we induce with some probing laser source. We focus it and image everything using a bank of optics, and we record everything on a series of fast avalanche photodiodes. The types of excitations that we're inducing look something like this. So by crossing two high-powered pulse lasers at a fixed angle on the surface of the sample under interrogation, we can induce standing surface acoustic waves by heating the sample in a periodic pattern. Now, these surface acoustic waves, and you'll hear me talk about surface acoustic waves a lot, can be monitored to understand the thermal and elastic transport properties of the materials under investigation. So if this is the side-on view, imagine we're going to flip the sample up and look at it spot-on. So if we're exciting acoustic waves in a finite region, we can park a probing laser into the center of that region and use the displacement that these waves make as a diffraction grating itself to monitor the intensity modulation of those acoustic oscillations. Now, that's great. This is a technique that's been around for a little while. We've been playing with it, modifying it. But to be able to show that it's actually appropriate to use for a nuclear materials diagnostic, we have to answer some questions. Now, the first of those questions is sensitivity. Are we able to detect changes in material properties using this technique on the order of the changes that are expected as a result of radiation damage? If the answer is no, then it's not very useful for us. The second is resolution, and by resolution, I mean in time and therefore in dose. Can we see changes at very small timescales? If the collection time takes hours for every one of these measurements, it's also not going to be very useful for a real-time diagnostic. And finally, predictions. We'd like to be able to make predictions based on simulations to see how the response of materials might change as a function of radiation exposure. With heterogeneously complicated damaged microstructures, you're getting away from the area that elastic and thermal theory can tell you how the material should respond. Now, I'm going to brush over about 2 years of work in 10 seconds right here when I tell you we can answer all these questions. And the answer is yes. It is appropriate for the use case that we want to use it for. And if you want to know how we've shown all those things, I'm more than happy to talk about it. But a more interesting question for me to show you today is, what have we done with the technique so far? Now, sort of the last thing we need to do before we're fully justified in strapping one of these onto an ion beam line and taking this data in real time is looking at actual irradiated material ex situ on our benchtop experiment here at MIT. Now, what we've done is we've irradiated a matrix of single crystal copper samples at high temperature. This was done last fall at the Sandia Ion Beam Lab. We shot for a range of doses at peak from 0 up to 100 dpa. On the right here, I'm showing you the damage curve as a function of depth into the surface of material for this ion exposure. And I've also marked the probing depth of the methodology that we're using. Another important point is we're only sensitive to layers near the surface of the sample, which is great because ion beam damage is localized to the surface of the sample. And we can match that perfectly, and that is not an accident. Now, before I talk about what this response looks like, just another little primer on FCC metallic crystals, in case you're not familiar. This is the 111 plane in an FCC metallic crystal, and there are two directions that I'm going to talk about today, the 111 bar 0 direction and the 112 bar direction. And we're going to talk about this crystal as a function of surface rotation, so imagine rotating this sample and keeping the polarization of the acoustic wave that we induced fixed. Now, if we look at the acoustic response of one of these samples that's not damaged, we see something like this, where the surface acoustic wave velocity varies continuously as a function of relative angle on the surface. Now, we can turn on our beam and start to irradiate these samples. And for our lowest exposed sample, we see a stiffening of the microstructure. So both along the fast direction, the 112 bar direction, and the slow direction, the 11 bar 0 direction, we see that the acoustic wave speed goes up. At the next dose, at 10 dpa at peak, we see some recovery and some softening along the fast direction, and a general recovery along the slow direction. If we continue at 30 dpa, the softening continues along the fast, and not much is happening down here. 50 dpa, the trend is the same, and at 90 dpa is as high as we went to, we see a significant softening along the fast direction and a very small change maybe along the slow direction in this metallic single crystal. Now this, at least for me, is enough to say this is a change that we can see using this methodology. So let me build it. I'll build the new experiment, we can do it right now. But to understand why the response looks the way that it does, we can take a look at the microstructure of this irradiated material. And I've actually shown you this picture already. That's what this image was before. So in reality, this is a high angle annular dark field scanning transmission electron micrograph, or HADIF stem image, of this microstructure. And again, the matrix is light and the voids here are dark. And the first thing we can do is we can superimpose the damage profile as a function of depth from the surface. And then we can note several of the characteristic features of this. So we see these large crystallographic voids. We also see a localized region of high density but small size voids near this implantation peak. And finally, we see this denuded zone near the surface where no voids have occurred. Now, these are all super interesting features, but as it turns out, they're all what you expect for high dose, high temperature irradiation. And what's interesting to us is we believe that the crystallinity of these voids is what's causing some of the anisotropic response that we see in our diagnostic. So if we go back again and look at this data, what we can say is this shows, to us at least, that the technique we're using is sensitive enough that we are justified in trying to build one of these in-situ materials diagnostics. You can picture as a first cut, maybe orienting your crystal along this one direction so you know you'll see the biggest change. But in any case, what we'd like to do and what we're doing moving forward is developing this diagnostic for in-situ ion beam irradiation monitoring. And that's our goal. That's what I have to do before I can get out of here. And we're really excited about what sort of new fundamental data about the material kinetics and evolution this can tell us. And with that, I'd like to thank everybody that I work with, Mike, Pengwei, Sarah. No work here at MIT happens in a vacuum, especially experimental material scientists. So thank you to everybody. And with that, I'm happy to answer any questions that you might have.
Do you want to be basically orienting your crystal in a specific way relative to your setup to see this large change? It's easy when you're doing, but when you're doing benchtop stuff, you can rotate the material. Yeah. If you're trying to do this in an actual reactor, are you going to be able to get your setup small enough and flexible enough that you're actually going to be able to move it relative to what you want to look at to get everything oriented just so that you can do it to the, in the correct direction?
Well, the answer to that question is, one, under an ion beam, not in reactor. That's not what we're trying to do first. Second, you can orient these crystals ex situ using another technique first, and then just put it on the stage in the right direction when you put it in. That's not really a, I don't know what happened. This is mine. I'm not too worried about it right now. So you can orient your sample before you put it in, and we're not super worried about that. In the end, when you're looking at engineering scale materials, so ideally you'd look at materials where you can average over many grains, so you get a uniform response. And in that case, the response should be isotropic. So you wouldn't have to care about this directionally dependent stuff. But for a first cut, for single crystal materials, you do. And that's why we're caring about it now.
Thank you.
I was curious, I didn't see the numbers exactly, but I was wondering, in the results you showed, it sort of looked like you got this big change
yep.
in your measurement at first, and then it kind of didn't do much, and then you got a big change in your last result. And I was wondering if that change in your measurement is linear with DPA, the linear thing. If there's some sort of non-linear in your measurement that you understand, or some correlation.
So it will be, I'm sorry, this is fiddling with me, but it will be nonlinear, and there's good sort of material science reasons for that. So the initial effect, as you're pumping this material and putting many small defects in, you get a stiffening because for whatever dislocation microstructure you have in there, you can essentially reduce the amount of, this is a hard one to explain. So initially, a dislocation density in a material will cause it to respond a little bit softer than a pure material with no dislocations would, because of how, essentially, that depends on how long the lines of the dislocation pin segments are. As you pump it full of small pinning sections when you have not much radiation damage, they act as pin segments for dislocations, which shortens that length that you can bow out, which stiffens things. But then as you pump it full of voids, the mechanism then becomes a softening as a function of the density going down and the elastic modulus going down. So the trend where the initial rise and then fall is something that we expected as well.
This is a much better measurement of what's really going on in the material and the radiation damage mechanism than a straight DPA, which seems to mask that effect.
Yes, so we're not. I think our picture of the situation is we don't care what number you put on the exposure, we care what the microstructure looks like and how it responds. So we're almost trying to circumvent the thing where you have to slap an exposure label on it and talk about the material properties as a function of change in properties themselves. Because when you're designing an engineering system, that's the part you care about.
And the onset of this large change, so 50 to 90 PPA, mm-hmm. where you have the large change,
yeah.
the cell change, is that consistent with the onset of void swelling from what these materials should do, or is it a different?
So,
it's really high PPA.
Yeah, it is. We expect it, and from the micrographs that we have so far, it seems consistent with the void swelling. We're working our way down in dose, and we haven't gotten all the way to the end yet to see what the 5 and 10 dpa microstructures look like in the stem.
Right.
But so far, the softening trends are consistent with void swelling occurring. So even in the 50 dpa sample, you still see crystallographic voids, a relatively large density of voids, but less than the 100 dpa. So far it's consistent, and we have to continue doing the transmission electron microscopy to find out.
Any other questions?
All right.
Question about the Michigan results that you showed. You were plotting the swelling versus dose, something like that.
Yeah.
And their error bars were enormous on the swelling. Why was it so large? Do you think it's as simple as just measuring something with calipers?
So that swelling, because it's an ion beam measurement, what they have to do is they take a very thin section of depth into a material, and they essentially image analyze that to count the number of voids, to calculate an amount of swelling. But to do it for a fixed dose, they have to take it somewhere along that damage profile that I showed you. And the reason that the error bars are so big is because there's error in how you count an image analysis. I think those error bars from that study were also for 3 samples, and there's a huge amount of sample-to-sample variation when you get up to such high doses, too. And that's also something else that we like that we can sort of get away with, because if we're doing this sort of in-situ real-time monitoring, we don't have to worry about sample-to-sample variation. We can compare directly to the material from its pristine state to its exposed state and not worry about any other variation, because slight changes in temperature or handling conditions or anything like that can all induce changes.
So those were like systematic error bars.
Yeah.
Not random.
It's, I think they were both.
Great. So let's thank Cody.
Okay. Oh, wait, I have to turn this down.
Yes.
And this talk is on piecing together the reactor puzzles. I'll give you a sample of this one.
Okay.
To not do that.
All right. Yeah.
Probably
going to be a little bit over that.
I can give you a sign in 10 minutes also. We went to speed up.
Okay. We'll see. Is that okay? Higher? How about that? Yeah? All right. All right. Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Derek Gaston, and today what I'm going to be talking about is modeling and simulation of nuclear reactors. And specifically, I'm going to be kind of focusing on one area, which is called multiphysics. And this is really just a small piece of what we do in the Computational Reactor Physics Group, or CRPG, here at MIT. So as a motivating problem here, let's think about trying to predict the failure of nuclear fuel inside of a reactor. So if you're unfamiliar with light water reactor fuel, it looks something like this. You have these long, thin fuel rods. And inside of those rods, you stack up uranium dioxide fuel pellets, a whole bunch of them, in fact, like 300 or more. And then you take a bunch of these, like thousands or tens of thousands of them actually, and bundle them all together, put them inside of your reactor. Fissioning process does its thing, generates a bunch of heat, remove that with water typically, generate electricity, okay? That's a problem for a lot of other people here. what I really want to focus on is the fuel itself and how can we actually come about predicting what happens to the fuel under irradiation inside the reactor. Because if we could actually accurately predict the fuel, it would mean that we could create better fuel. We could create more reliable fuel, more accident-tolerant fuel, safer fuel, more efficient fuel, okay? And one of the things we want to do is try to actually predict fuel failure, all right? Because fuel failure is messy, costly, nobody wants that, right? And that's when, essentially, the stuff inside of your fuel rods makes it out somehow, okay? So this is kind of a motivating goal, is can we accurately predict the process of fissioning inside of fuel and the material science and everything going on with the fuel in order to actually be able to better design fuel. The problem is that the process of what happens to fuel is pretty complicated inside of a reactor. And this isn't meant to be funny, but it is to me anyway. This is an actual diagram from Lastman, from a journal article in 1980, where he actually sat down and tried to show all the different physics happening inside of a reactor and how they are intercorrelated in order to come up with the ultimate behavior of what happens to fuel. And if you look at some of these bubbles here, I don't know if you can read all of them, but there's things like coolant temperature and power, which kind of makes sense. And then there's other things like densification, fuel stress, creep rate. And what we need to do is try to come up with some software that can actually model all these physics simultaneously and all their interdependencies in order to predict the ultimate behavior of fuel. And in order to do that, I would take these things and kind of classify them in kind of four different areas here. So there is neutronics, which is basically the actual distribution of neutrons throughout your reactor. Thermal hydraulics, which is how fluid moves through your reactor. Thermomechanics, which is kind of the mechanical and heat conduction response of the fuel and everything else in the reactor. And then tied in with all these is very important material science as well, because the environment inside of a reactor is obviously very harsh. We have irradiation, we have high pressures, we have high temperatures. And so, as we just saw from Cody's talk, lots of material changes happen inside of the reactor. And so what's needed really is to come up with a piece of software that can not only do each one of these things individually, which a lot of people have worked on over the years, but actually do all of these things simultaneously, all right? And resolve all the interdependencies between them.
And that is a thing that we call multiphysics. So in multiphysics simulation, what we're trying to do is actually resolve all these different physical phenomena and all the linkages between them. And we're going to do that by essentially solving multiple sets of equations simultaneously and feeding their results back and forth between each other. You can see that over here on the right. This is kind of a toy problem of heat conduction and solid mechanics. We're solving a set of partial differential equations here for a heat conduction solve in order to get a temperature. And then we're taking that and passing it over into a solid mechanics solve and looking at kind of the thermal response of that material to this temperature field, right? In this case, just thermal expansion here. And then we would actually pass that back and forth and maybe go back and forth here. And there's a lot of different ways you can actually go about achieving a multiphysics simulation, okay? But the basic problem is that we saw that huge bubble diagram of, I don't know, however many, 30 different bubbles or whatever, right? And so you don't really want to just pass back and forth between all 30 of those bubbles. It's not really going to work out. So you really need to take a more sophisticated approach at developing your software so that you can actually solve for all these different physics and resolve all the interdependencies. And that brings us to a piece of software that I started about 8 years ago at Idaho National Laboratory called MOOSE. It stands for Multiphysics Object-Oriented Simulation Environment. And the basic plan is that it's a finite element multiphysics framework that allows scientists and engineers to plug in all of their equations, all their partial differential equations, all their ODEs, and then MOOSE, hopefully with any luck, will go off and kind of solve that system of equations for you and give you back kind of the multiphysics response of your system, all right? And we've used this a lot over the last 8 years to do a lot of different things. You can see things up here like geomechanics, reactor transport. So it's being used in lots of different areas. But obviously, our main focus has been on reactor simulation, using it for nuclear engineering. And this is all open source and freely available. So feel free to go to mooseframework.org, check it out, join the community. It's a very vibrant, active community. So go check that out. And that brings me to a list of collaborators because, as Cody mentioned, I mean, we can't get anything done in nuclear engineering without a lot of collaborators. And all the results I'm getting ready to show you, all of these people played a role in that. I don't have time to go through the full list, but I do want to point out my advisors, Ben Forget and Cord Smith, who do run the Computational Reactor Physics Group here at MIT. And then, of course, always the ultimate enabler down here, Richard Martineau, who, if you don't know him, you should, but he's my boss at INL. Okay. So let's go back for a second to that puzzle, that set of puzzle pieces that I was talking about, and kind of look at each one individually. So the first one is going to be thermomechanics. And the basic idea here is that we have just a combination of heat conduction and solid mechanics with a bunch of other kind of phenomenon thrown in. And really, this is going to be the primary thing that's going to govern the gross behavior of the fuel, the engineering structural behavior of the fuel. And some of the important behavior here is going to be thermal expansion, densification, which actually there's extra porosity in the fuel, and it's under high temperature, high pressure, and so it's actually going to shrink just a little bit or resist thermal expansion some. After irradiation, there's swelling, like Cody was talking about. You build up voids and everything inside the material, and it actually swells and moves. And then there's also pellet cladding interaction. So you have these pellets, as you can see over here on the right, that are moving around inside of their tube, inside of the cladding. Eventually they swell out and actually run into that metal tube. And there's a really complex process there. So this movie I'm showing over here on the right is a simulation from a MOOSE-based application that is built for simulating nuclear fuel. This is a full 3D simulation with every single fuel pellet inside of a fuel rod discretized. So these are the kind of high fidelity multiphysics simulations that we're looking for that can give us that predictive behavior so that we can actually try to predict when fuel would fail and try to design better fuel. Okay. So our next puzzle piece that we need to look at is the thermal hydraulics. And basically, this is just everything about the coolant and fluid flow through your reactor, all right? And often, we kind of get away with using 1D models here, although there's a lot of research here at MIT on doing much more complicated 3D full computational fluid dynamics here, which is ultimately needed for predictive capability. And I want to point out that the fluid in your reactor can be many different things depending on your reactor design, all right? So we're not only just talking about water here, not only just steam, but other things like molten salt, lead, et cetera, okay? So you need to be able to model that flow through your reactor, the uptake of heat from the fuel, and ultimately your electricity generation cycle. And this movie that I'm showing here is just a simple toy test of another Moose-based code called Relapse7. That's just showing kind of an oscillator here of a two-phase fluid simulation, just a really simple toy problem. The next piece of our puzzle was neutronics. And this is obviously really important. It's how you actually solve for the neutron distribution in your reactor, both where they are and how much energy they have. And this is what's going to ultimately give you actually the power in your reactor and the heat generation rate. And it turns out there's lots of different ways to solve for this neutron distribution, including Monte Carlo methods. There are methods that are called SN and PN. I don't really want to get into what they mean. I'm just kind of listing them out here. But then method of characteristics, but really the workhorse still in industry is still this guy down here, diffusion. Okay. And it turns out that that's really not very good, but it's what is ultimately used everywhere. And so a lot of our job in the computational reactor physics group is developing these more complicated methods and making them usable and fast and efficient. And to that end, here at MIT, we do develop a lot of codes, including OpenMC, which is Monte Carlo, OpenMOC, which is a method of characteristics code, PinSpec, which is a slowing down code. We have lots of different codes within the CRPG. And then ultimately, this code down here that I've developed called Mockingbird that I'm going to talk a little bit more about in a moment. Now, this movie that I'm showing here is a benchmark result from another Moose-based application that's just showing a prompt supercritical reactor transient, basically, where the reactor comes up to power, and you can see the power here. But then there's a coupled temperature simulation going on as well. And as the temperature of the fuel comes up, you can actually see the depression in power here. And so this is showing just how interlinked these different physics are. The temperature of the fuel directly impacts the neutronics. And obviously, the neutronics is driving the temperature of the fuel. So it's a very complicated nonlinear system that you need to solve. So moving on to Mockingbird. Mockingbird is a new tool that I've developed here at MIT. It's an unstructured mesh method of characteristics code, which probably doesn't mean much to you. But the unstructured mesh part means that it's very generally capable of solving in lots of different geometries. So we can look at things like next generation reactors, for instance, and test reactors and things like that. And it directly couples to any other Moose field. So we can solve for heat conduction, we can solve for fluid flow, and we can pick that up and actually have it impact the neutronics directly. And then it's also very massively parallel, so we can solve really large, full-core 3D systems, okay? And this movie that I'm showing you over here is actually showing a solution scheme of coupled temperature and neutronics here. And you can see the neutronics kind of go crazy for a moment. And what that is this is an all-new way of solving Boltzmann transport that was developed by John Tram over here within the Computational Reactor Physics Group. This is brand new stuff as of last year. It's called the random ray method, and it's just getting published now, so you're kind of getting a sneak preview of this. But it's a really cool new way of solving this neutronics problem. All right, so let's put all these pieces together. We've got neutronics, thermomechanics, and thermal hydraulics. So the way this is going to work, we're going to have neutronics feed our thermomechanics a fission source. That's pretty obvious, so that we can get our heat source. And then coming from the thermomechanics, we're going to get back fuel temperature, which is going to impact our neutronics solve. Neutronics is also going to just feed the total power down to the thermal hydraulics. Right now, there's lots of different choices here. This is going to impact our coolant temperature and our coolant density. And that coolant density is going to head back to the neutronics, which is going to impact, again, the neutronics very heavily, as you'll see here in a minute. And then these two here are linked through a boundary condition. The outside of the fuel basically needs a temperature from the coolant, from the water that's flowing over it, okay? And so here's a simulation that uses all those pieces. So we have our neutronics, we have our heat conduction, and we have our coolant flow here. And this is one assembly, so it's a 17 by 17 set of fuel pins. And these over here look kind of funky because I've sliced them in half and kind of stretched them out so that you can actually see what's going on, okay? But the assembly actually looks like this. And this is just a 48-hour power ramp, just a straight linear power ramp from zero power to full power. And what you're going to see is the neutronics come up to power, the fuel temperature is going to come up, and the moderator temperature will also start to rise as we start to start the reactor up here. And maybe? I got a wrench? No. Is it going to work? Yes. Okay. So our fuel temperature starts to come up, our moderator temperature starts to come up, and then if you watch very closely, especially watch right over here, you'll be able to see that as the coolant temperature rises, especially in the top of the reactor, you'll get a depression in the neutronics up here, which will actually shift the peak flux down towards the bottom of the reactor. It's a thing we call axial offset. Happens in real reactors. And that's just a hallmark of actually seeing all the interdependencies here between all these physics. So we're actually solving for all three of these pieces of this multiphysics puzzle together here in one code at one time. All right? And this is going to allow us to actually create predictive simulation. I do want to point out that Mockingbird is very massively parallel. This is a plot going from 8 processors out to over 13,000 processors on a cluster. And it's doing very, very well. The blue line is Mockingbird, by the way. The green line is, well, it's some BS. But it's a bulk synchronous ray tracing method. But the blue line is Mockingbird. We're doing really, really well. So if you're interested in massively parallel computing, the CRPG is one of the places where you can get that done here at MIT, because we develop massively parallel codes. All right, the last thing I'm going to leave you with is basically our end goal here. And this is a movie from a demonstration I did a few years ago where I linked together several Moose-based applications in order to model a full AP1000 core, all 40,000 fuel rods inside of it, over multiple fuel cycles. And what you'll be able to see, actually, is the reactor come up to power. And then, so this is kind of thermal expansion. And then there's kind of this densification phase. And then ultimately, as we keep the power on in the reactor, you'll start to get fuel swelling here. And then it'll go through a reactor shutdown cycle. We'll shuffle around the fuel like we do in real life. And then we'll restart the reactor. We put a little bit of new fuel here in the middle as well. So this was really just a toy problem to demonstrate that we can actually solve, in a simplified form, neutronics, thermal hydraulics, and a full model for every single fuel pin inside of a reactor. All right? Now, this is still very far away from actually being predictive at this point. And that's where we kind of end with all the open challenges, because there's still so much work to do here. But it's very, very exciting that at this point we can start to link together all these tools and actually look toward a future where we can actually have predictive reactor simulation. Okay, thanks. Oh, yeah, I have to answer questions.
Thank you.
Yeah, so, what's up? Cody was first.
So your second to last bullet, what do you need from me to be able to make science-based predictive material?
I'm hoping you and Mike can actually do that yourselves, actually. But
related to that, you had 4 puzzle pieces at the end, and
yeah.
You dropped the materials.
I did, but no, that's completely a time thing. That's just totally a time thing. If you give me another 30 minutes, I'll do material science as well, because Mike and I have done a ton of work on linking material science actually into that full reactor calculation, in fact. So. I mean, things that we need from the experimental side are obviously just all the parameters that need to flow into the material science simulations that we do. So we can also do microstructure calculations. We have Moose-based applications for doing microstructure evolution calculations to actually evolve the voids around and grow and coalesce voids and interstitials and all that stuff. And then actually do kind of numerical experiments live while the simulation is running in order to feed back up material properties like thermal conductivity, Young's modulus, etc. But all that is really highly dependent on the kind of experimental work that you're doing at kind of the microstructure level. Yeah. Miriam, yeah.
All these methods were developed with an application in mind, so predictive fuel damage. Are these methods in the future going to be used for other predictions in the reactor?
Yeah, absolutely. I didn't mean to focus too much. That was just a motivating thing. Really, we want to simulate the entire reactor. It goes out from here. There's Moose-based applications doing seismic and everything else. And so we really want to link like all the way from maybe multiple miles around a reactor all the way down to the microstructure and do that full system. So it's not meant just for fuel simulation. That was just to kind of motivate us a little bit. Yeah.
Yeah, thinking about Fukushima.
Uh-huh.
So talk about fuel failure. You have a good example in Fukushima. What can you do in terms of predicting things that will future occurrence of Fukushima with regard to safety now?
Right. So I mean, there's a big effort right now in DOE in developing accident-tolerant fuels, right? And a lot of that is motivated by what happened at Fukushima. And so one of the things we can do with this framework is we can take a lot of the work that's going on in accident-tolerant fuels and actually try it out inside of our computational framework first and maybe help narrow down the types of experiments that need to be done. Ultimately, you're still going to have to cook and look a little bit, as Cody put, but you might be able to use predictive simulation in order to help narrow down the number of things you need to cook or only cook the most viable options, for instance.
Faster and faster, but massively parallel. Mm-hmm. You could do some, for instance, kind of, you know, thinking about the future of reactor safety, you can play all kinds of scenarios where you can get quick answers.
Yes.
Scoping answers.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
It seems to me that should be very, very helpful.
Yeah, absolutely. Agree.
I was wondering, where's the largest gap in this list?
Okay. Yeah, I think, wow, there's gaps everywhere. So, but I got to say, I mean, the area I work in, I guess I'll point it out. The top one is really a huge gap for us. Because actually being able to do high fidelity 3D neutronics is actually still wishful thinking in a lot of ways. I mean, we use the biggest supercomputers in the world in order to simulate one state point of one reactor, all right? And so getting that down and getting it into an efficient package where it can actually be used day to day for reactor design is actually still a huge, huge gap. Yeah.
One last question.
Yes. So I feel that you have like a very complete package of like physics, as you mentioned. You have like material science and mechanics, fluid dynamics, neutronics. It seems to me that, you know, My concern is how confident are you that your solutions are, you know, correct or realistic?
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, I mean, sensitivity analysis or something.
Yeah.
It seems to me that, you know, you have so many packages of physics, and, you know, just a very, I feel like maybe just a very small perturbation on, you know, on a temperature, on a surface, you know, that can create some neutronics or some sweating or something that can, you know, non-linearly, like, interact other packages of physics, and so you know, completely give an erroneous or a different solution. Like, do you have benchmarking with other codes or like with experiments?
Yeah.
Or
all of the above. I mean, verification validation is always an ongoing thing. Anytime you're developing a code, so for instance, the Bison code that I showed that was solving that full 3D fuel rod. I mean, we've run hundreds of cases of, you know, comparing to experiments, and then we compare to other codes and lots of different things. So each of the individual packages are typically validated within themselves. Getting experimental studies that have some of the integral effects in a way can be really challenging. And so there are some benchmark problems, and we do run those. Like the neutronics power pulse that I was showing is actually a benchmark problem. It's the LRA benchmark, and so it's a coupled heat conduction neutronics benchmark, and so we can run that with our code and see if we get out the correct answer. And so it's a combination of numerical benchmarks, comparing to experiments, and we are always actively, you know, actually looking at new experiments and helping to design new experiments to test out the codes. So it's an ongoing exercise all the time.
Thanks, Derek, again. Our next speaker is to represent the nuclear security studies in our department. And his name is Jason Robert. The title is The Less You Know, The Better.
That's really fancy, isn't it?
Good.
All right, good afternoon, everybody. My name is Jason Vavrick, and I'm here to tell you about some of the work we do in the nuclear security group at MIT, and why the less we know, the better. So in nuclear security, we're generally faced with making some kind of measurement, and a lot of the time, there's some restriction on the measurements you're allowed to make. And so the less you know about the things placing these restrictions on you, the better. So whether that's nuclear diplomacy in the case of the Iran deal, where you run up against issues of Iran's sovereign right to peaceful nuclear power, cargo interrogation, where you need to make a measurement very quickly so you don't run up against cargo throughput restrictions, or what I'll talk about mostly today in warhead verification, where you're dealing with issues of secrecy and classified information. So warhead verification. The idea in general is that you have nuclear treaties, mainly between the US and Russia, where the nations have agreed to eliminate some of their excess nuclear weapons. However, in the past, nobody has actually verified that the weapons being disposed of are real. And as I'll talk about later, this is a very difficult problem. So what people have done in the past is not verify the warheads directly, but used some kind of proxy. So for example, I show here a photo of a bunch of destroyed US bomber aircraft. It's very easy to put these out in the desert, let the Russians fly a satellite over top, and see that the warhead delivery vehicles have been destroyed. But in the future, these proxies just aren't going to cut it. At some point, if you're really concerned about reducing the total number of nuclear warheads in the world, you want to verify that you are getting rid of real nuclear warheads. So I'll try to explain this further by an analogy that I can't resist borrowing from my advisor, Arig Danagulian. So instead of a warhead, say I make a claim that I have a cute little bunny rabbit, but I can't let you inspect the cute little bunny rabbit. All you're allowed to find out is whether or not there is a bunny rabbit in this box. So one thing you might think of at first is take a DNA sample. The DNA sample will indeed tell you if it's a rabbit or not, but you'll also find out a ton of classified information in the process, like the rabbit's mass, its color, and its explosive yield. So people have come up with what they call the attribute approach, where they focus in on a few key attributes of the ostensible rabbit. So they put it behind a barrier or a curtain, and they make some classified measurements behind the curtain, and then only reveal binary true or false answers to the key attribute questions. So maybe you point out that, well, a rabbit should have long ears, it has big feet, and it has a big fluffy tail. And if you put the rabbit in the measurement system, you're going to see three check marks on the other side of the barrier. And it says, yes, great, it's a rabbit. Well, the problem with this is that Arig's dog also checks all those boxes. So we immediately see that there's this risk of hoaxes when you're using an attribute verification system. And that's because the attributes themselves aren't unique. Moreover, the attributes themselves might be classified. So if I tell you that a nuclear warhead, a real one, has to have so many grams of plutonium, that might be a classified fact. And moreover, it's hard to ensure that the barrier itself doesn't leak any classified information, or there's not some malicious action going on in the barrier giving a false result. So this leads quite naturally to what I call the disarmament verification problem, in that it's very difficult to reliably identify a warhead without revealing any classified information as to why it's genuine. But at MIT, we've come up with what we call the physical cryptographic verification protocol, which attempts to surmount all these problems. So we, instead of using an attribute approach, we use what's called a template approach. So you start with a golden copy of a warhead you know is real because maybe you've gone to a random ICBM silo and pulled it off of an active duty missile. So you can be pretty sure that this A0 warhead is real. Now, if you have a bunch of warheads of the same model that may or may not be real, you can go through and do some kind of comparison to the golden copy. Is candidate 1 equal to the golden copy? Is candidate 2 equal to the golden copy? And so on. The challenge here is to come up with a measurement system that can surmount all the attribute problems I mentioned earlier. So you need to be able to make these checks in a way that you're going to catch hoax devices, in a way that you'll identify all real warheads, and in the process reveal no classified information as to why these candidate warheads are real or aren't real. So there's this idea in computer science called zero knowledge, where you can prove a theorem without knowing any of the underlying info about why the theorem is true. And as a kind of physical analog, there's this idea of physical encryption. So you're encrypting information about the warhead as to why it's real or not, not using software or electronics or anything like that, but using a physics process, because you can't hack physics. And the technique we use is called nuclear resonance fluorescence, or NRF. So let me explain first what nuclear resonance fluorescence is. So say I've got a uranium-235 atom, which may be in a warhead. We know from nuclear physics it's got discrete energy levels. So there's one at 1.7-ish MeV. And if a photon comes along with exactly that energy, it can be absorbed by the nucleus. The nucleus will jump up to this excited state. The nucleus will then decay femtoseconds later and re-emit that same energy photon. If I've got a detector placed properly, it'll register a count at 1733 keV. Now, if I have a U-238 atom and the same energy photon comes along, the nuclear structure of uranium-238 is different, so the photon won't interact, not at least through nuclear resonance fluorescence, and my detector won't register a count. The point here is that the absorption and emission energies are determined uniquely by the nuclear structure, so by the nuclear energy levels of each isotope. Now, of course, the picture I presented in the previous slide is pretty simplified. There are way more levels in each nucleus. There are lots, so I show here three or four. And you can access all of them and generate a huge cascade of photons using a broad spectrum energy beam, where there's photons of all different energies that may or may not be absorbed by the nucleus. So my detector sees a whole slew of photons, and you can see a series of sharp emission lines, these peaks in counts versus energy, corresponding to these nuclear structure, the nuclear energy levels. And the series of peaks you see, the centroid energies of each, are going to be different for every isotope you can think of. So U-235, 238, plutonium-239, and 240. Those are the weapons isotopes we're mainly interested in. So how do we put this into a measurement apparatus? Well, to start, we're concerned with not revealing any classified information during this NRF measurement. So we break our lab into two regions, one in which everything is classified by the host, that's who owns the nuclear warheads, and one in which everything is open. And that's where maybe an international arms inspector can be. So we start with this golden copy warhead, the one we know to be real. And then we place beside it this encryption foil, which contains all the isotopes of the warhead, but in unknown amounts. And if I have a detector and some shielding, and I irradiate this golden copy plus foil, encrypting foil system, I'll see a bunch of NRF photons in my detector. Now, if I do the same thing for a candidate warhead and look at the NRF spectra in the detector, I'll see, hopefully, if the warheads are the same, I will see the same spectrum. So the way the measurement works is you compare the NRF spectra. If they match within some statistical test for the golden copy plus foil versus the candidate plus foil, then you can be reasonably sure that the golden copy indeed matches the candidate warhead, and therefore the candidate is also real. So there's a kind of encryption going on where, again, you're only measuring the combination of the foil plus warhead. You never measure directly the warhead itself, because if you did that, you could determine a lot of classified information. So again, this is encryption by a physics process rather than software. So we actually ran some simulations to prove this concept. Going back to what Derek said, these are some reasonably massively parallel simulations. So we just fire a bunch of photons at a model warhead. and look at the energy spectrum, this NRF energy spectrum of all the photons from this warhead plus foil combination. And we see some spectrum, which doesn't tell you anything on its own. You need to compare that spectrum against other scenarios. So I mentioned you want to be resistant to hoaxes. So one thing you can test is, well, what if you put in some kind of hoax device? So say you slap together a bunch of weapons usable material in a non-weapons usable configuration, some slabs of uranium and plutonium, and you make the same measurement. Well, does our measurement technique pick that out as a hoax? As I'll show you in a minute, yes. But there are a ton of other hoaxes that you might think of. One really interesting one is if, say, you take the valuable weapons-grade plutonium and swap it out for something less valuable, like, say, depleted uranium. So if you do that, and I'll let this play a few times, make the measurement, you watch the NRF spectra grow as your measurement time goes on. The NRF peaks resulting from the nuclear resonance fluorescence interaction are clearly visible in the photon energy spectrum. And then if you compare the two spectra from the two scenarios, you can clearly see that some of the line heights are significantly different in the final result. Let's play once more. So to look at this statically, there's a lot going on in this plot. But if I can draw your attention to just two particular NRF peaks. The black curve shows the genuine warhead NRF spectrum, and the red curve shows one of these hoax devices I mentioned. And the discrepancy in the line heights here is gigantic, much greater than 5 sigma in reasonable measurement times. And in fact, is for this particular scenario where I've replaced the weapons-grade plutonium with depleted uranium, it's over 100 sigma, which is a very strong indicator that there's a hoax. Of course, that's a fairly easy hoax to detect. Something more interesting, as I mentioned, is maybe swapping out the weapons-grade plutonium for fuel-grade plutonium, which is something you might find in something closer to a reactor. But there's still a 14 or 15 standard deviation discrepancy in some of the plutonium NRF lines. So again, it's a very easy hoax to detect. This geometric hoax I showed, which mimics the appearance of the warhead from one particular projection, in its original configuration, it's actually undetectable. It beats the system. But if I rotate it by even 10 degrees, it becomes immediately obvious with a 7 standard deviation discrepancy that it's not a real warhead. So simulations are great. I could spend a lot of time talking about simulations, but ultimately we need to prove this in the lab. So I showed you this picture earlier, and we're actually down the street at the High Voltage Research Lab. We're trying to do a proof of concept of exactly this. So we start with a 2.5 MeV electron accelerator and slam it into a copper and gold target. That produces this broad spectrum Bremsstrahlung beam, which is capable of accessing all the NRF states in our depleted uranium target. This produces the NRF spectrum that we observe with a high purity germanium detector. And some data from this past summer actually suggests that things are kind of on the right path, where the proof of concept is progressing. We might actually be able to prove that this verification system does indeed work in the laboratory. So if you look here, you can see the three major uranium-238 resonances. Of course, we can't get access to weapons-grade material, so we're stuck with uranium-238. So you can see the three major resonances, which are a direct result of the nuclear structure of uranium-238, as well as their branch decays, 45 keV below the main energy, which is due to this intermediate level. So you have this kind of coupling between fundamental nuclear physics in a laboratory setting that ultimately allows you to make very very strong measurements of a warhead in a very political context, I guess. So some of the next steps we have left to do are to finish validating this whole approach using theory and simulation and experiment. Ultimately, we need to do a proof of concept with not just the depleted uranium foil, but something like a thick target as a surrogate for a real warhead, because we're not going to get real warheads. Along the same lines, we can't get even samples of weapons-grade material, so we need to collaborate with the national labs. So there's some opportunities there. And we would also like to investigate more hoaxes and, you know, pin down exactly that there's no information leakage. So in summary, we've made the first isotope-specific physical cryptographic verification technique that should work for verifying arms reduction treaties. We've done some proof of concept simulations that suggest that this is experimentally feasible. And there's a lot of ongoing laboratory work, opportunities for students in validation, further proofs of concept, information security, sensitivity of the protocol, all these areas. And it's a promising technique, and there's still lots of technical challenges to resolve. So with that, I'd like to thank my collaboration, mostly Arik Danagulian, Brian Henderson, Rory McDonald, and I'm not going to get into math. Thank you.
Also, it's totally fine to take the theory behind it. It's just the time. So, questions for Jason?
So, with the position of the warhead, actually give you some information, if you look at the spectrum?
The position of the warhead?
Like the warhead, the rotation, okay? Do you look at the spectrum, give any information about the warhead itself, even if they are the same kind of spectrum?
So, any information about the warhead is, you know, scrambled by the presence of that foil. So there should not be any information about the warhead itself on its own.
Do the targets have to be, I guess, oriented in the exact same way for the NRF spectrum?
Yes. Yeah, so you could imagine a warhead that's not perfectly spherically symmetric. In which case, the exact orientation will differ depending on how you rotate it. That will change the NRF spectrum, because the NRF technique is actually sensitive to the geometry as well. So they do need to be the same. Yes.
In this protocol, how do you ensure the security of the foil?
So the foil also has to be classified. So I showed it in the classified area of the experiment. So that means it's under some joint custody. It's classified.
But jointly, so you know that your host is switching.
Exactly. Yeah.
How fast can you do this
measurement? So the speed of the measurement depends on a lot of factors, mostly the current of the accelerator and the number of detectors you use. But the simulations we showed would take tens of minutes, if not shorter. In a realistic lab, yeah.
And what must you do to make it faster?
Faster? You can use a higher current or add more detectors. Yeah. Let's see.
How do you know when you've tested enough hoax cases? So is there a physics-based shortlist for which you satisfy it and know this is going to work?
That basically comes down to our own creativity. So anything we can think of, there are some hard mathematical limits on the geometric hoax cases you need to test. But as far as different types of hoaxes, yeah, that's purely a function of what we can come up with.
So if there are no further questions, let's thank Jason. Do not leave at the end of this talk yet.
Where's remote control?
Very important person, Nancy, will have a couple of announcements for you, and then we will also, of course, go over the poster session.
So, hello everyone, I'm Chutong Zhou. I'm a fourth year PhD student working in Plasma Science and Fusion Center. Today I'm going to bring you something which may have less nuclear flavor to it, and it shows you the diversity of research that we do in this department. So today I'm going to talk about understanding plasma phase space holes using hole tracking particle in cell simulation. And so first I'm going to start by introducing the physical system that I work with. And so on the left, I'm showing you a box of particles representing a fluid that many of you in the department are very familiar with and work with in your daily research. And a fluid is normally characterized by high density, low temperature, and is dominated by binary collisions. And on the right, I'm showing you a box of particles representing a collisionless plasma, and that's the physical system that I work with, which might be less common, and it's characterized by low density, high temperature, and it's dominated by long-range electromagnetic interactions. Because in a plasma, all the particles have charge, and they feel this long-range electromagnetic field. So we say a plasma is collisionless when the mean free pass between collision is longer than the system size that we care. For example, a perfect example of a collisionless plasma would be the Earth's magnetosphere. And there, the mean free pass between collision for both proton and electron is on the order of 10,000 kilometers, which is comparable to the diameter of the Earth. So the system is effectively collisionless. And a collisionless plasma has many fascinating physical properties. And the main phenomenon that I'm interested in this collisionless plasma system is our electron holes. So many people may be more familiar with electron holes in a semiconductor physics context. And actually, when you think about electron holes in a collisionless plasma, it's somewhat analogous in the sense that it's a localized deficit of electrons. So here in the bottom left panel, I'm showing you the electron phase space. So the x-axis is the position and the y-axis is the velocity. And I'm plotting all the constant energy contours, which are the electron orbits. And you notice that some of the orbits are not connected to the outside world, so that they're trapped in this phase space. And these trapped orbits are shaded. And if there's deficit of electrons on these trapped orbits, they will give rise to a positive potential, which is shown on top. And that positive potential will in turn trap them. So it's a self-consistent equilibrium in a collisionless plasma system. And the reason why we call this structure an electron hole is because when you look at the plasma when you look at the electron distribution function, which is plotted on the right, and this is a distribution function landscape, it basically tells you for a given position and a given velocity, how many electrons are there in that there is a dip in the distribution phase space density of electrons at the position of the electron hole. So it's effectively a phase space hole. And how these things can, the reason why this is relevant in a collisionless plasma because this distribution is highly non-Maxwellian. So if you look at it, there's a dip in the middle, and in a collisional system, it will relax to a Maxwellian. But in a collisionless plasma, this structure will exist for a long time. It's a very robust structure. And electron holes can arise from phase space instabilities. So here I'm going to show you a video of how electron hole formation. So we start with so here again I'm showing you the. I'm showing you the electron phase space, and you the x-axis the position, y-axis the velocity. You have two electron populations counter-streaming. They have different velocities. They're coming towards one another. And this system is unstable. It's subject to two-stream instability. As you can see, as the instability goes on, it will form these basically phase space vortices, which are electron holes, and they will coalesce. To even form bigger ones, and this is the process by which these electron holes are formed in the space. And so electron holes are observed, are actually observed in space. So lots of satellites are launched to measure the Earth's magnetosphere. Here I'm showing you an example of the, this is a magnetospheric multi-scale mission, a cluster of four satellites which were launched by NASA. And each of them have six electric field sensors, and they basically, they do in-situ measurement of the plasma environment in which they're traveling. And in the data that they send back to the Earth, of these satellites sent back to the Earth, people notice that these satellites often encounter a very spiky structure of electric field. So here I'm showing the electric field measurement in one of these satellites. And if you zoom in to look at the detail of these spiky structures that these satellites encounter, you will notice that they're almost all composed of these bipolar structures of electric field, which is a characteristic of the electron hole, because if you take the derivative of a positive potential pulse, you get a bipolar electric field. And the mystery about these electron holes is that people don't actually know how they move. People actually don't know what determines their velocity. So the measurements from space suggest that there is a wide range of velocity for these electron holes. Here I'm showing you a plot of basically the measurement. The black circle is the electron hole velocity measurement. And I would like to draw your attention to the orders of magnitude in that velocity. So it's log scale, so basically it ranges over three orders of magnitude, all the way from 10 kilometers per second to 1,000 kilometers per second. And people never really understood why this is the case. And so the fundamental question is, what determines the velocity of this electron hose? And to answer this question, I think we need to have an ethic theory and also something to compare with. So what we choose here is a high-resolution first principle simulation. And today I'm going to focus on the simulation aspect of our work, because I'm not going to bore you with all the equations. And so the simulation technique that we choose for this work is called the particle-in-cell simulation. And I think the name is self-explanatory. In a particle-in-cell simulation, I'm showing a cartoon of how this code works. So basically, you have spatial grids, which forms these cells. And in the cells, you have these particles, which are plasma particles. And you do charge weighting on the grid, as this diagram shows on the right. And then you can solve for the field on this grid. And then you use the field that you solve for to solve the force that's exerted on the particles. And then you can advance the particles, so on and so forth. And this advances in time. And the challenge that's associated with doing a peak simulation for these electron holes are the following. So first, you need an open boundary, open boundaries to simulate these things, because you don't want the electron holes to be interacting with itself. And the holes are moving quite fast, and so it's a very localized and fast-moving object in a simulation domain. And the peak simulation is very sensitive to noise. You need a large number of particles in order to reduce the statistical noise. And so this noise is very sensitive to particle density in that simulation. So this all imply that you need if you were to choose a static domain, you would need something, a big simulation domain with lots of particles, which is a high computational cost. And so the idea is why not having a simulation domain that can self-consistently follow the whole motion. And so basically, when the hole moves in a simulation domain, we'll just move the domain accordingly to track its motion, kind of like a camera tracking an object. And so in order to do this, we actually need a feedback control system. And so feedback control is a concept that we borrowed from the control theory. And you can actually do this in a simulation as well. In this diagram, inside this red box, I'm showing you the structure of a common peak code. So you have a particle mover, you have particle injection at the boundaries, and the Poisson solver to solve for the field. To do this feedback control, you need some actual blocks. And the first thing you need is a hole tracking block that tells you where the position of that feature is in the simulation domain. And then it gives you the position and the velocity of that feature. and it needs to go through a low-pass filter because the time step we take for these simulations is very small, and the velocity is very noisy from that simulation, from that whole tracking algorithm. And then we pass this through some sort of a control mechanism. This will tell you the acceleration that's needed for the simulation domain to exactly follow the motion of the feature. And this acceleration and the velocity of the simulation domain is actually very important for the need to go back to the peak code, because the domain is no more an inertial frame of reference because it's accelerating. There's an inertial force arising from the acceleration. Also, the velocity determines the distribution that you're drawing from to inject particles. So this loop needs to be closed. Here I show you how our algorithm actually works. And on the left, again, I'm showing you the electron phase space contour. And here I'm showing you the formation process of the initial formation process of an electron hole. So you see, once it forms, it feels an acceleration actually here, in this case, which accelerates it to the right. And some people call this a self-acceleration, and that's because it's interacting with ions. And on the right, I'm showing you the red curve is the velocity of the electron hole. You can see that there's a sharp rise caused by this initial acceleration, and the blue curve is the box velocity. And the box is doing a good job to follow the velocity of the electron hole. Not only it's tracking its velocity, but also it's tracking its position to always center the feature, the electron hole in the simulation domain. So we've done a benchmark to show that this new sort of a short domain self-hole tracking simulation gives exactly the same result as a fixed domain run. So here I'm showing you the agreement between the two runs. So we essentially can achieve the same precision, but with a domain which is much shorter. So here is a short run case, it's four times shorter and four times less particles. And for longer runs, we may even have a much bigger speed up, because the speed of a pico basically is the time of a pico basically scales linearly with the number of particles in there. And the big advantage of having a whole tracking peak is that it offers a very good flexibility to explore a wide range of parameters, because you don't have to worry about losing the thing that you're trying to simulate from the simulation domain. And then here I'm showing you that we've done these runs exploring a 3D parameter space of different parameters. We've studied this initial transient acceleration very carefully and its dependence on the initial velocity, on the mass ratio, and on the size of the electron hole. And so, and the solid lines are from our theory, and there is very good agreement. And one of the other thing you can do with a whole tracking simulation is that you can study the off equilibrium case. So here what we do is that we apply some acceleration to the ions, and we see how the electron actually reacts to it. And this actually reveals some very interesting coupling between the electron hole velocity and the ion momentum. So here the blue curve is what we call a pushing case, is that when we accelerate the ions towards the electron hole velocity, and the electron hole velocity will immediately react to it, it will also accelerate. And it's as if it's pushed in the velocity range. And in the same token, you can do pulling as well. That's when you accelerate the ions away from the electron holes. And this pushing and pulling is reversible, and it's asymmetric. And so this effect itself is very interesting, because it reveals a momentum coupling. And there's no collision in this system. But because of the existence of electron holes, momentum can still be transferred from the ions to the electrons. And also, this provides us with a chance of exploring electron hole of different velocities almost continuously. And so, which was especially the slow electron holes, which were difficult to access before. So we explored we discovered actually slow electron holes can experience an oscillatory velocity instability. So here I'm showing you a case of that instability. So on the left, you have the potential and the ion density before the instability, and on the right, you have the potential and the ion density after the instability onset. The bottom panel actually shows you the velocity of the electron hole in the ion frame. You see that if it slows down, if the velocity of the electron hole in the out frames falls below a certain threshold, then the oscillation in the velocity actually begins to grow, and this whole system is unstable. And this, the significance of this discovery suggests that some of the slow electron holes measurement that were observed in space that I showed you before might be, they're susceptible to this instability, so that they're candidates of driving outheating and anomalous resistivity in space plasma. And here comes the conclusion, the simulation domain, so we use this technique of hole tracking, and the simulation domain can be greatly reduced. We studied the full dynamics of electron holes interacting with ions, and the agreement between our theory and the simulation is very good. This work is supported by NASA, and here are some of the related publications if you're interested. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you. Questions
for Derek?
What's your plan for multiple holes?
Oh, for multiple holes. So, this is a very good question. So we the justification for doing this solitary hole simulation is that in space, because the main factor that will influence the hole velocity is actually the ion, is what's happening to the ions. And so it's normally in the context of the magnetosphere, the ion temperature is very high, so that there is strong ion Landau damping. And so the ion perturbation from one electron hole may not be able to travel to reach the other one, so that they're, in the sense that they're well separated, so that it can be considered as a, so that they can be treated separately. And also it's because by doing a single hole simulation, we're able to actually to compare it quantitatively with our theory, because I guess multiple hole theory is very hard to do, and already a single hole theory is actually quite difficult. So it offers us this quantitative comparison between the theory and the simulation to validate our theory. Actually, there's a whole theoretical aspect of this work that I'm not showing here.
So originally your electron hole that's already it's an instability, right?
Yeah, it's a phase space instability.
And then you close saying that these holes are also unstable.
Yeah, they may they cannot travel in a steady state fashion if their velocity is too slow.
So what does that mean if that hole is unstable? That it disappears, or it's, you have turbulence that.
Oh, it means that, yeah. So what happens is that as I show here on the right, so the whole potential will oscillate. So its velocity will oscillate, will drive these acoustic waves, and also will this will lead to trapped particle detrapping, and the whole amplitude will basically decay, and can eventually disappear. Actually, yeah. So this coherent structure will be destroyed. The hole will disappear, yeah. It can be destroyed by this instability, actually, yeah.
There was one more question.
Yeah.
You mentioned one of the generation mechanisms for creating these electron holes was electron-electron two-stream instability.
Yeah, yes.
Is that the driving creator of the space environment?
In space, yeah, okay. So in space, normally the instabilities are like, you can have these beams, like electron, like beam type of instability. So any, it can be current driven. It can be a Budman type of instability, which is current driven, or it can be, as long as you have a very cold beams that's somehow created by the space environment, and it will lead to the generation of these electron holes, basically. Yeah. So a beam in the phase space. Yeah. Did that answer your question? Yeah.
I guess the only beam is, you know, the solar wind and
the sun. Oh, yeah, because.
Where's the other? I guess if you're motivating the two streams.
Yeah, yeah. So I guess the space environment is really very chaotic. There can be like these magnetic reconnection and all kinds of other particle acceleration and these violent release of energy. And these instability mechanisms, they will create these structures. Yeah.
Thank you.
Lang. So as I said, there are two more announcements. One is by Nancy, whom I would like to thank very, very much for all of her hard work and dedication to making sure we conduct this event very smoothly.
Thank you all for coming. I hope you've had a good day. I'd really appreciate it if everyone could dispose of their trash. There's bins here and in the other room. And anyone who has a poster out in the hallway, just remember please to remove it. Thanks.
Thank you again. All right, so I would like to thank also on behalf of the faculty, the really excellent speeches on the different research teams in our group, and the really high quality and exciting poster presentations. We were really, really pleased with the attendance and the work that was discussed by the poster presenters. Thank you very much for putting effort to make it a great event. And I'm not thanking you for making it difficult for us to choose the poster winner because of this. In fact, it was quite a discussion. But there were five faculty people, right? And we enjoyed many of these posters. So we could not choose one, but we chose two. All right, so I'll announce them. And so I'll announce in an arbitrary order, but equally. All right, so first one is by Yixiang Liu. Congratulations, both of you.